Our first speaker is Virginia Magnaghi from the Scuola Normale Superiore. Ma da dove? Where is it?
Pisa.
Doesn't say Pisa here. But here we say she's a PhD candidate in art history at the Scuola Normale Superiore. Oh, it says in Pisa. Her doctoral research focuses on the pictorial and literary representations of Italian rural landscape under fascism. She is currently a visiting fellow at the Environmental Humanities Laboratory at KTH Stockholm, where she is working on the possible contribution of art history to landscape studies. In 2021, she was a research fellow at the Center for Italian Modern Art in New York, working on the artist Mario Schifano. I have an artist in my office. I have to show you, a landscape artist, Italian-American, who went to Italy. And he doesn't know what else to do with his paintings, so they're sitting there. So afterwards, yeah, and her talk is entitled Central Italy's Countryside in Il Sole a Picco, 1929, writer Vincenzo Cardarelli and painter Giorgio Morandi facing natural landscape. And our second speaker is Daniel Rizze? Wow. Who is a PhD candidate in Italian studies at Brown University, where he is also working on his master's degree in religious studies. His research focuses on Catholicism in 20th century Italy, including the church's encounter with modernity, religious dissent, and the relationship between theology and literature. His dissertation, entitled Catholic Ecology, Reinhabiting Italian Landscapes, 1918 to 1965, has been granted funding from the Institute at Brown for Environment and Society, and argues that Catholics' increased participation in Italy's public life between World War I and Vatican II converged with contemporary environmental crises to generate a renewal of cosmologies that valorized the earth. Daniel holds a bachelor's degree in Italian and English literature from Yale University. And we'll start with Virginia. Thank you.
I'm presenting a paper which is part of my PhD dissertation, which deals with a representation of Italian natural landscape under fascism. And today we'll deal with a specific case study, which is this book published in 1929 by writer Vincenzo Cardarelli and illustrated by 23 drawings by painter Giorgio Morandi. So let's stay for a second on Giorgio Morandi, since he's today a well-known painter, highly quoted in the international art market, especially in the U.S., he has quite a good fortune. And he embodies a kind of interesting duplicity, having divided the last generations of scholars between those who stress the formal characteristics of his works and the formal reading of his paintings, and instead those who insisted on a more contextual reading of Morandi, insisting on how he was a fascist man in the fascist period. My hope is that an approach which combines art history for sure, but also literature, also environmental history and cultural history, can bring to a better balancing of these two antithetic ways of looking at Morandi, and possibly of looking at Italian artists during the period of the 20s and the 30s under fascism. At the core of the paper lies landscape, which was the real protagonist of this book by Cardarelli. Morandi's drawings and Cardarelli's proses and poems offer a unique opportunity to read two different yet resonant narratives on Italian countryside at the time. For both the protagonists, landscape was a key topic, and maybe highlighting their resonances and discrepancies is a way to shed light on how painters and men of literature were looking at Italian nature at the time, and to frame their gaze on nature and to frame their position in that landscape. Also, I believe it's a way to assess the contribution of my discipline, which is art history, when looking at the immense topic of natural landscape and of its representation, of its meaning, and of its role in shaping a community and in shaping a nation. So my idea is to tell you something, give a little bit of context to the project of the book, then delve into the book thematically, and then finally to dedicate some room to the editorial context where this book fits in, as I argue that this book was actually totally immersed in an editorial project where landscape was a crucial protagonist. And so looking at the other books which were edited in those same years by the same publishing house, which was L'Italiano by Leo Longanesi, is kind of interesting to, again, look at the topic of landscape. So a little bit of context. Vincenzo Cardarelli was born in 1887 in the middle of Lazio, in Corneto Tarquinia. And then he moved to Rome. His education was irregular. And in Rome, he started being a journalist and very famous writer at the time. Giorgio Morandi belonged to the same generation, being born in Bologna in 1890. He went to the academy of his city. And actually, instead, he was not a traveler, as Cardarelli was. Indeed, he was a very solitary man and quite affectionate to his places in Bologna and the surroundings of the city. Both of them met in Rome at the end of the 1910s, between 1918 and 1919, where Cardarelli was a famous writer, directing La Ronda, an Italian magazine, and Morandi was visiting his friend Raimondi, Giuseppe Raimondi, who was another writer, friend of Cardarelli's. 10 years and many more facts later, this book came out as a collection of 12 poems, 9 poems, and 23 drawings, 22 plus the one in the cover. The position and the role of the two authors at the time was quite different. Cardarelli was famous and renowned. Morandi, instead, was in a difficult yet pivotal year. In that 1929, he was appointed teaching of engravers at the Academy of Bologna. And of course, that meant for him entering into the system of fine arts and having a position as a teacher was something that he obtained thanks to his closeness to fascist intellectuals, such as the group of Il Selvaggio and Strapaese, so a group of intellectuals who were supporting a wild, original fascism still linked to the squadrist roots of the movement. So it is thanks to this milieu that Morandi, for sure, obtained that position and obtained success, and also managed to exhibit at the Venice Biennale from 1928 onwards. Now the situation is the opposite, with Morandi being very famous, as we said, and Cardarelli being maybe forgotten by the public. I don't know. Yes, probably yes. So let's move to the book. December 1929 in Bologna, Le Edizioni dell'Italiano, and the publisher was Leo Longanesi. So some letters clarify that Cardarelli had actually no idea about the drawings. I mean, he was very curious to see the drawings he was writing. And here we understand that this unique result, this cannot be named as a poet-painter collaboration, since the two of them actually did not collaborate. They were not speaking. And the assemblage was a sort of ex post combination, where there was no dialogue. Cardarelli, instead, and Longanesi with Cardarelli, were trusting Morandi. And choosing Morandi was, for both of them, a declaration of esteem, of admiration, but also of confidence, since they believed that Morandi's inclusion in the project would actually perfectly fit in that project, and that they both resonated and the combination was resonating in a broader project. For sure, the 23 drawings did not take much time to Morandi. I mean, they were all taken from etchings that he had previously realized. At the end of the 20s, Morandi was really into engravings, engravers, and all the drawings were made through the tracing of previously realized etchings. Though the number of the drawings, which is which is 23, encourages thinking that this was not simply a matter of handling drawings to a friend, but that there was an actual alignment between the two of them. So the goal of the second part of this paper is to explore this alignment and to see how Morandi actually resonated with this project. The first aspect, I would name it formal loyalty. These are the beginnings of the first two sections of the book. On the left, you see a poem, Santi del mio paese, and a prose on the right, Il mio paese. As you see, each chapter of the book began with a drawing by Morandi. Cardarelli was promoting a genre which was particularly keen on the formal quality of the text rather than on the narrated events. And landscape for him was an excuse to actually concentrate on the quality of the prose rather than on the content. There wasn't a real story, there wasn't a real narration going on in his pages, but actually landscape was a sort of excuse, a pretext, to insist on the formal characteristics of his text. And it was a way, of course, of depowering the content. We can easily understand this alignment with Morandi in the sense that he was a painter whose attachment and loyalty to his lands and to his landscape is probably the most renowned characteristic of Morandi. Morandi being a painter completely into two genres, still lives and landscapes, and completely being repeating the same motifs for all his life. Indeed, on the same level of formal loyalty, yet stands another powerful element, which we might call as a combination of nostalgia, attachment, and possession. So besides the formal alignment, we also see that both landscapes and still lives, so Morandi's genre, and Cardarelli's way of insisting in his nature, depict something through which both of them want to underline an intimacy with, something which was their own, someone's places, their places. They wanted to show their origins. They wanted to show their objects in the case of still lives. For both of them, and for both the authors, landscape was something, was theirs, was their own. They were showing something which they really cared about. It's clear, though, that this closeness is an ambiguous one, or maybe fake. Though we might want to avoid some too much deterministic conclusions, much of Marx's literature on landscape has very well cleared that the same notion of landscape, its possibility, is given for outsiders only. And I assume this is an intricate issue for researchers working on landscape too. I mean, our position, or at least mine, is that of an outsider. Also the idea of Morandi painting landscapes, never being on plein air, but always looking at the hills, maybe through a telescope, doesn't give us the idea of someone really immersed into nature. Their position is quite ambiguous. On the one side, we really see the attachment to their place. We really see the idea in both of them of putting into the canvas or into the text, in the case of Cardarelli, something of one's own. And on the other side, there is an unbridgeable distance between their gazes and the actual, real, concrete landscape, which is also made of labor and fatigue, and which is instead totally purified, at least purified from any social conflict in the paintings or in the texts. The Italianist Pier Vincenzo Mengaldo had put it splendidly by saying that the fact that 20th century lyric poetry is punctuated by attempts at immersion or regression in peasant civilization is itself an outcome of this unbridgeable distance between writers and the actual landscape, the concrete landscape. Cardarelli himself actually gave us a hint in this letter to his friend and writer Linati in 1916. He was writing as a piece of advice to his friend, non ci vada troppo in mezzo, don't go too far into it, into nature, reduce it to spectacle, to myth, to hallucination. So the topics could be many more. Actually, let me just enumerate them very quickly. For sure, Catholic religion is a crucial element we have not named, but which is crucial both in Cardarelli and Morandi. I mean, the two texts, you saw them, Santi del mio paese. But there's not only a more blatant reflection on religion. I mean, the churches and the bells and the processioni in the countryside. But there is also a more intimate religion, which we could name a sort of rituality and spirituality, where also the act of repetition itself, or going back to the same motifs, both in Cardarelli and in Morandi, who were so repetitive, is actually suggesting an emotional and devotional approach to the countryside and to the cyclic nature, this nature which is something which repeats itself. And here my references to literature and cultural memory and ritual by Ian and Aleida Asman in particular. But throughout the text, many more aspects come in. As we were saying, Morandi was a solitary man, and instead Cardarelli was a traveler. Yet in Cardarelli, the motif of going back home, of going back to Il mio paese, was quite a contradictory one. He rarely went back to his country. He felt a connection to it. And at the same time, he wanted to leave immediately as soon as he went back. He used to call himself a sybarite of distance, a guzzler of desire. And maybe these two poles of distance and desire are an interesting way of seeing these contradictions that we've seen till now. A final comment on the editorial context, the editorial project. So, as we were saying, Leo Longanesi and L'Italiano in Bologna at the end of the 20s, the review L'Italiano also had a publishing house, which was named the same, L'Italiano, and which was active between 1927 and 1931. These were both Morandi and Raimondi, the Morandi's friend that we mentioned before, were a very important part in the editorial project of L'Italiano, as these two cartoons show. So they were very close to Longanesi, and they were part of their projects. These were the eight books that were published together with Cardarelli's, which was the ninth, in those 4 years. And in all these nine books, eight plus Cardarelli, landscape plays a crucial role, which still needs to be assessed, probably. So if it's true that Morandi's and Cardarelli's book had a sophistication and had a formal quality that we mentioned at the beginning, which was very high, and which, in a sense, recedes the book from the most rhetoric and parodistic images of landscape, of fascist landscape, it is also true that this book perfectly fits into this editorial project, which tells us something different. There were books such as Panebigio by Telesio Interlandi. This was the first edited in this collana. Interlandi, of course, a Sicilian born in 1892, the journalist who founded La Difesa della Razza, the official broadcasting body of fascist racial ideas. His book inaugurated the series, and it was a collection of political essays. The preface was written by Vincenzo Cardarelli. And in the preface, Cardarelli meaningfully insisted on the title of the book, Panebigio, that is, and I'm quoting, bread that is neither luxury nor for delicate stomachs, but rather a bread of penitence and of cheerful eve. Commanded bread, bread of our days, dark and poor, steeped in sacrifice, hard-earned, humble, mystical. This ethic of sacrifice, hard work, humility, and religious devotion, according to which the Italian farmer is able to take care of the Italian land, and I'm quoting, with filial devotion, with keen intelligence, and with unshakable faith. Well, this ethic of humility, of humble, close objects, is shared by both the landscapes and still lives that we've seen till now. Also, Bacchelli, La Ruota del Tempo, this was the second book, Proses and Poems, dedicated to the seasons and to the Bolognese countryside. So again, Bologna, Bacchelli was a really close friend of Morandi, they knew each other very well. And the title and the colophon of the book had a portrait of Bacchelli, who was engraved by Giorgio Morandi. But we could go on. There's also Giuseppe Raimondi, the one we've mentioned before. There's Lorenzo Montano. Lorenzo Montano, another outcome of La Ronda magazine, the magazine of Cardarelli. There was Antonio Baldini. There was also a woman, Rosetta Parini Colombo, on the second line. She came from Canton Ticino, and she was a strong battler for the Italianità of Canton Ticino. Ever since the 1910s, she adhered to fascism, and she believed in fascism as a way to assess the Italianity of Canton Ticino. So in all these books, landscape plays a crucial role. It might be the Swiss one, it might be the Swiss-Italian one, the Bolognese one, but landscape is the real protagonist of all these nine books. And we've seen the recurrences. I mean, there's always the same circle of people. There's Morandi and Cardarelli continuously coming back, but also it's an intertwining of the same names. And yet the cruciality of landscape needs to be assessed and affirmed. Il Sole a Picco, apparently the title was chosen by Longanesi, and Cardarelli didn't know anything about the title. It was a landscape to show that the title, Il Sole a Picco, might have been chosen by Longanesi, thinking about Morandi's landscapes, if you think of those landscapes without any shadow. And if Cardarelli really didn't know anything about this title, maybe Longanesi chose it thinking of Morandi. And of course, and this is my final remark, we might name the fact that the nature of Lazio and Emilia enters into this book. But it's veiled. It's veiled by many things. It's veiled by the complacency of the exercise, so the formal quality that we mentioned at the beginning. It's veiled by the perfection of the result, but also by the deep impairment of this book within the culture of the time. And Italy at the time was also defining itself as a country, also from the point of view of geography. Geography was a new discipline, and geographers were learning how to describe Italy at the time, and its new geographical unity. And so nationalist physical geography also could give us some hints, we don't have time today, but maybe in further research, to see how these descriptions of landscape dialogued with those descriptions that nationalist geography was learning how to do at the time. So at this rich crossroads, I hope we can situate this small publication and study its richness through the entanglement of many disciplines different. Thank you so much.
So I had a question about sort of the character of both the landscapes in the text and the imagery. You mentioned this sort of idea of national geography, but would you say those landscapes similarly promote a sort of universal sense of Italian landscape, or are they particular to the regionalities of these figures?
The situation is different for the two of them. I mean, Cardarelli, we said, was a traveler, and in the book we not only have Lazio's landscapes, but he also describes Venice and Naples, and he really used the other villages also to write about himself and his relationship to his own Lazio. But really, landscape doesn't come into his text as geographically connotated. It was more really a formal pretext. In the case of Morandi, it's different. I mean, his titles are always very generic. It's always landscape, landscape. It's never Grizzana or Bologna. It's always landscape. And yet, they are totally adherent to nature and to that peculiar nature. So title, in a sense, lie, and they are very much situated in that context, in that Emilia.
So first of all, thank you for that quotation. I think it's fantastic about, the sybaritic, et cetera, et cetera. I was thinking that actually that is a phenomenal definition of memory, but especially of memory in the guise of nostalgia. And so I'll take that away. But a question I had for you is, I would love you to tell us a little bit more about the book as an iconotext in itself. Mm-hmm. So the fact that you told us at the beginning, it's an assemblage, it wasn't, Cardarelli didn't necessarily know. I would just love to know more about how it functions as a combination.
So you have to imagine 130 pages, as we said, 12 proses and 9 poems. And at the beginning of each one, there's a drawing. It might be, as in this case, half a page on the left. It might also be one entire page. I don't have the image here, but so this can change. The book is not long. It's 130 pages, and they're quite small, the dimension. There are only 3 still lifes and 20 landscapes. So that's how it works. And they're all taken by previous etchings, realized mostly between 1927, 28, and 29. Some of them at the beginning of the 20s, just a couple of them at the beginning of the 20s. And the other interesting aspect is that Cardarelli describes many different places of Italy at the time, but not Emilia. So there is never Bologna. They don't match geographically exactly.
So in that sense, paradoxically, the images feel a gap.
Exactly. Another interesting aspect, if you read the reviews of the book at the time, is that some of them completely forget about Morandi, because Morandi was not known at the time. I mean, he was 1928, his first Venice Biennale, but only as an engraver. He was not exhibiting paintings, so it was not known. It was everything at the beginning. And some others do. But the real protagonist was always Cardarelli, also because in 1930 he won a very special prize with his book, Premio Bagutta, which basically was the way in which he earned money, since prizes were the ways writers earned money at the time. And so the book was popular and re-edited, and the way of the two authors was different in this sense.
Well, thanks for that very interesting talk, Virginia. I was especially struck, and I think it was more in the context of your discussion of Panibigio, of the theme of sacrifice. You talked about the sacrifice, as I think the word you used, and the humility of the farmer, which was interesting because that ties together the sort of themes of a national project and also, obviously, is a sort of religiously laden language. And so I'm just wondering if, and it provides a sort of opportunity for thinking about the interaction between humans and the landscape in this literature. So I was just wondering if there was anything else you might share about your reading of that theme. And I guess I'm particularly wondering if the sort of the kind of sacrifice that goes into the work of humans raising bread applies at all to sort of an idea of sacrifice of the landscape, and if that sort of pushes back at all on sort of an idea of landscape as protagonist. So just generally, I guess, how that theme fits into your reading.
Sure. So the theme of sacrifice in Cardarelli comes in often, and it's often declined as the sacrifice of workers and the sacrifice of peasants. And of course, it's a kind of elitarian regard and view and gaze from Cardarelli on the workers. And that's how it comes in. And it always comes in associated with the words such as humility, humble. And it's also associated to a sort of rituality in the sense that work is something ritual that happens every day, and it's something which is also which also involves a sacrifice, and it's something that happens every day, such as, for example, to make you an example, the noise of the bells recurring in the landscape where these workers work. I think this is very interesting, especially if we consider all the literature that has said that a painting of landscape genre can be also a religious painting, and so can have this religious subtext coming in from sort of background. This is how it comes in Cardarelli. In Morandi, it's quite different, though. We never see. Actually, we don't have fields. We don't have work. For sure, we don't have workers, but we don't really have fields either in Morandi's paintings, though. Literature here played a role, since Morandi was told as a solitary man, who very religious man, and so this religious narrative of Morandi comes in this sense, and it, you know, writers of the time and his friends were underlining how much he had this devotional approach to nature. Of course, it's a narrative, but it's what has arrived to us today.
Can you expand more on the letter, the excerpt you have about the letter where he says, be detached from the landscape,
sure,
and treat it as a myth, as a spectacle? Maybe this also relates to the distance from the sacrifice of the workers.
Sure, exactly. I mean, here we are a little bit earlier. The letter is 1916. La Ronda was not founded yet, the magazine, which was founded in 1918 by Cardarelli. And Cardarelli was in Rome, still beginning as a journalist and as a writer. Linati was younger, and this was meant as a suggestion to a friend. I think Linati had sent to Cardarelli something before to read, and Cardarelli had commented upon that, saying, keep the distance, keep a distance, don't go too far into it. So that's the context. And I would associate this to all the writings he was preparing for La Ronda, from 1918 to 1922, the journal was open, but he had prepared the material before, so also in these years.
Thank you all for being here this morning. Luigi Sturzo is remembered as the father of political Catholicism in Italy. He was born in 1871, a year after the Kingdom of Italy had annexed the Papal States. And as historian Francesco Malgeri has noted, he was part of a transitional generation of Italian Catholics who set aside the old dream of restoring the papacy's direct temporal power in favor of developing new ways for the church to engage in modern civic society. As a priest in Sicily, he founded rural cooperatives to help small peasant farmers in an economy dominated by large estates. He advocated Christian democracy as a way for the church to respond to the socioeconomic needs of the masses. And after the trauma of World War I, he was influential in Pope Benedict XV's repeal of the policy that had previously prohibited Catholics from participating in Italian parliamentary politics, thus allowing him to found the Italian Popular Party, or PPI, a party of Catholic inspiration that ushered Catholics into the full political life of the nation. In the early 1920s, the PPI was a source of resistance to the fledgling Fascist Party, and while Mussolini's consolidation of power prompted Sturzo to flee into exile in 1924, first to London, then to Paris, and eventually here to the U.S., he remained a voice of anti-fascism until his return to Italy in 1946. It's not surprising, then, that scholarship on Sturzo tends to focus on his overtly political and sociological texts, overlooking several theatrical plays in verse that he wrote throughout his life. These plays aim to be a popular educational theater to promote religious enthusiasm and model the civic commitments that should come from the Catholic faith. Il Ciclo della Creazione was one such play, which Sturzo wrote from exile in London and which was published in Paris in 1932. In it, the Sicilian priest recounts the existence of the cosmos in four acts: God's creation of the earth and Lucifer's rebellion against God, the creation and fall of Adam and Eve, the incarnation of Christ, and the coming apocalypse, or supposed end of the present world. I invite you to consider Sturzo's Ciclo with me today, because it offers insight into the environmental imagination of a politically engaged priest. It suggests that Sturzo's politics, both his anti-fascism and more generally his conviction about the church's responsibility to engage in modern Europe's public life, were underpinned by his understanding of human entanglement with the material stuff of our planet. Although the Ciclo contains no explicit mention of contemporary Italy, Sturzo's political investments are thinly veiled in the play. In the first act, Lucifer arrives in the midst of his angel troops as they prepare to rebel against God. The troops, standing in formation, acclaim him with a cry taken up from rank to rank, "Lucifer, viva, viva!" Then they chant a war anthem repeated throughout the battle. "Viva, viva, our ranks will be victorious. Viva, viva, our Duce will triumph in the heavens." Referring to Lucifer, of course, with the title for leader assumed by Mussolini. The familiarity of the angels' vivas was not lost on Benedetto Croce, who read the play and in a letter to Sturzo asked him if his rebellious angel shouts were not really quite fascistic. "Does it not seem strange," he went on, "that these fascist sounds should have resounded in such remote times, even before the creation of the world?" Sturzo's association of fascism with cosmic evil is yet more striking in the final act. There, the events of the apocalypse center on the city of Jerusalem, which has become a dystopic city, the nucleus of a sinful humanity that has abandoned God, and which in Sturzo's description looks a lot like fascist Rome. He writes, quote, "The Jerusalem of the end of the world no longer preserves any memory either of Judaism or of Christianity. It has become the capital of the world, center of exchange between East and West. Having eclipsed its Jewish and Christian pasts, this Jerusalem has entered a third epoch, not unlike fascist Rome, which was fashioned by Mussolini's regime to be a third Rome that would surpass the glory of the Rome of the emperors and the Rome of the popes." As historian Aristotle Kallis notes, this third Rome was similarly to be, quote, "the locus of an international universalist fascist political religion that would radiate across the world, and its projected image drew on the myth of Mediterranità, which posited Italians as the inheritors of the empire that once stretched west and east across the sea." Fascist architecture, we know, combined classical motifs of columns and arches with the severe edges of modern rationalism, a style evoked in Sturzo's description of this city's, quote, "imposing constructions, its architecture, quote, a mix of Greco-Roman and Eastern with a modern feel." In totalitarian fashion, the Antichrist who rules over Jerusalem and whom the people worship in a temple claims supreme power over life and death, including with the fountain of youth he keeps in the city center. Sturzo describes squadre di giovani, squads of young people who march through the streets singing about gathering, quote, "the flower of youth and love blossoming in the April of one's years," and we recall the cult of youth central to fascist mythology. The party anthem Giovinezza with its ode to youth, youth, springtime of beauty, the regime's promotion of physical education, and Mussolini's own image as Italy's strong man, whom a New York Times correspondent described in a 1926 article as having such smooth skin and bright eyes, he might have bathed in the fountain of youth. The illusions that cast the apocalyptic city as an allegory of fascist Rome and the Antichrist and Lucifer as models of Mussolini situate the play on a political plane, inviting us to read its account of the origin and development of the earth in connection to 20th century Italy. From here, two paths open towards Sturzo's environmental thought. The first is an ecological critique of fascism itself. Lucifer begins his campaign against God with an effort to conquer the material elements of the cosmos. "Al pensier di Lucifero," he proclaims, "si scuotono gli abissi e l'inerte materia si solleva come a novella vita." At the thought of Lucifer, the abysses will be roused and inert matter will arise as though to new life. To his henchmen, he commands, "A voi soggetta sia la materia, a voi il sussulto dell'acqua, l'ardor del fuoco e della terra I germini. To you may matter be made subject. To you the movement of water, the heat of fire, and the saplings of the earth." When Sturzo penned these lines, Mussolini was several years into his own agenda of mastering the elements of the natural world. In 1925, he declared the Battle of Wheat to achieve national food independence, an initiative that, as Thiago Saravia has recounted, involved the techno-scientific development of more efficient strands of wheat. Grain production increased, but so did the use of chemical fertilizers and industrial apparatus of monocultural farming that accelerated soil erosion. The late 1920s also saw the beginning of Mussolini's land reclamation program, the draining of swamps and marshes to convert them into arable fields and new towns. Federico Caprotti has dubbed this initiative creative destruction to convey its ambivalence to local ecosystems and damage to natural watersheds. The environmental harm done by reclamation, however, was also rhetorical, since it presented mastery over the swamps as a way to regenerate the nation and prove Italian greatness. Not unlike Lucifer's talk of making inert matter rise to new life, fascist discourse spoke of wild nature as untamed and barren, waiting for human ingenuity to redeem it and make it fruitful, and it thus promoted belief in human entitlement, even duty, to conquer the earth. Sterzo's critique of fascism's environmental impact is evident in moments of the play when characters describe the consequences of Lucifer's and the Antichrist's proto-fascist regimes with reference to material landscapes. One of God's angels, for example, calls Lucifer's power abuso contro il creato, abuse against creation, noting that as a result of him, quote, fire, water, air, and earth have been loosed from their harmonious circle and are returning to the chaos of shapeless matter. Describing the earth at the time of the Antichrist's rule, another character speaks of, quote, le zole infette, le acque inquinate, l'aria impura dei peccati dei uomini, the infected clods of soil, the polluted waters, and the air made unclean by human sins. And another observer of Jerusalem's totalitarian regime laments that while the earth once spoke to humans in, quote, the mystical language of its green silences, its translucent blue mountains, and its deep seas, it has now been made mute. Muta è la terra. It would not be until 6 years after the play's publication that the Italian fascist forestry corps would plant trees on the side of Mount Giano in the Abruzzo in the arrangement of giant letters spelling the Latin form of Duce, thus branding fascist speech onto the landscape and, we might say, rendering the earth mute. But it seems Sterzo already perceived the danger of an ideology that cast nature as the silent, inanimate building stuff of humans' political projects. It's also telling that during Lucifer's attempted rebellion, his goal is incessantly described as that of establishing dominion. May the universe be Lucifer's dominion, il dominio di Lucifer, he proclaims early on, then tells his henchmen to announce to the four winds, quote, il dominio di Lucifer, and invites the angels coming to hail him to participate in the dominio of the cosmos. When one angel asks another about Lucifer's intentions, he is told his one thought is dominio. Does he want to have dominio over the whole Empyrean? The angel asks for confirmation, and then relays to another, did you hear? Dominio is Lucifer's one word. This is all uttered in the play's first act, which recounts God's creation of the universe. Just before the rebellion, onstage voices describe light erupting into primordial darkness and the earth emerging with rivers and seas and mountains. One thus cannot help but hear the repetition of dominio as a commentary on the notorious words from the book of Genesis. God's instructions to humankind to have dominion over every living thing that moves upon the earth, which some have cited as evidence of Christianity's culpability in our present environmental crises. As uttered by Lucifer, dominio indeed becomes exaggerated, fetishized, a potentially dangerous concept that Sterzo suggests is prone to misuse. By relating Lucifer's aim to be duce of the angels to his conquest of the material stuff of the universe, the word dominio points to an ecological critique of fascism as political form, that because fascism endorses absolute power, it perpetrates human ambition to establish unfettered lordship over the earth. Writing in response to totalitarian Italy, Sterzo thus drew from his historical moment a theological insight akin to an admonition against humans' tendency to, quote, worship earthly powers that Pope Francis makes in his 2015 encyclical on environmental care. Such tendency, Francis says, results in us, quote, usurping the place of God, even to the point of claiming an unlimited right to trample his creation underfoot, end quote. Besides the eco-critique Sterzo makes of fascism in the ciclo, a second path leading from his politics to his environmental thought emerges in the play. This one deals more with how he understood humans' connectedness with material creation as a priest who innovated ways for the church to participate in Italy's public life. Consider that the ciclo's political allegory reaches its zenith in Sterzo's image of the third Jerusalem of the apocalypse, in the face of the material world's ostensible fleetingness. The action of these pages revolves around the verb fuggire, to flee. As the skies over Jerusalem darken, the people beg the Antichrist for help. Dacci il sole che fugge, dacci l'aria che manca. give us the son that flees. But one who has remained faithful to God advises the people to turn back to God, quote, before the mountains fall on top of you, before the sun is extinguished above you, before the earth flees from beneath your feet. Pria che la terra fuga. Then, just before the sun burns out, the people ask it to return for another moment. Bacia la terra ancora pria che ti fuga lontana e crolli negli abissi, e raggia alle bellezze fuggitive della natura. Kiss the earth once more before you flee away and shine down on nature's fleeting beauty. It's one of the scenes in which Sturzo most makes plain his own political investments as a vocal anti-fascist priest, and yet the repeated verb fuggire alludes to the objection that the project of political Catholicism is most susceptible to. This world is passing away. The modernist priest Ernesto Buonaiuti noted in his Storia del Cristianesimo that the dilemma Catholicism faced in the early 20th century, as Catholic social teaching was introduced and Christian democracy grew as an idea, was how to requalify Christianity's implicito renegamento del mondo, the renunciation of the world implicit in its eschatological expectations. If Christians' true home is in heaven, and if this world will end, then why should they care about the political, social, or for that matter, environmental affairs of this world? Sturzo's approach to this problem hinges on the verb fuggire, which gestures back in the play from the moment of the earth's apparent evanescence to his account of how humans came to dwell on the earth in the first place. In the play's second act, we see Adam and Eve observe the sun on their first evenings in the Garden of Eden. Gazing at the horizon, Adam addresses the sun. O sun, supreme star that warms and embellishes, to Fuji, you flee towards the distant horizon, like a horse galloping through the sky's spaces. But you will return to make the earth beautiful, to fertilize plants and revive animal senses. The next night, we hear Eve's voice at dusk. Flowers of the fields and flowers of the woods, on the fresh grasses and at the banks of the river, you smile at me with enchanting colors. The sweet air beats my brow and stirs my hair with a gentle rustle. Ma perché fuggi, o sol? O sun, why are you fleeing? Do you need to rest in the bosom of the ocean? Here, the fleeing sun does not indicate imminent apocalypse, but marks the daily rhythm of creation. As these humans take in their environment for the first time, they recognize it as a place that moves through time. Fuggire makes the passage of time dynamic and continuous, and gives the sense of life on Earth as unfolding in a slippery, fluid sort of way. Adam and Eve's observation of time as an element embedded in the composition of the earth points us back yet further in the play to the long period of waiting that elapses between the beginning of the first act, when light breaks into the darkness and earth is created, and humans' appearance in the second act. In the intervening pages, stage directions indicate una pausa, come se la natura stesse aspettando. The angel Gabriel then foretells the coming of a new creature. Quando I pianeti dall'ignito vortice rotiando nei secoli avran germinato le piante, e i fiori daran mille odori, e di vita posente palpiterà la terra, verrà la nuova creatura bella simile a Dio. Here, the combination of the futuro anteriore and the futuro semplice eloquently elongates time, such that the when of this creature's arrival is made distant and indeterminate, and creation seems to lean forward in anticipation. The second act finally opens in Eden, but before we actually see Adam walking around, we hear the voice of nature invoke this new creature's coming. Vieni o desiderato, ti aspettiamo dai secoli, and again the stage directions call for silence con un senso di aspettazione. The idea of nature waiting for humans' arrival at first seems to be a case of blatant anthropocentrism. The stage directions describing Eden just before Adam appears note birds singing, waters flowing, and winds murmuring through the trees, but nature's beauty at this point is, quote, senza unificazione. The playwright calls for musical tones to be played that are, quote, analytic, fractured, and scattered, to convey that the earth has its vegetal and animal life, but, quote, it does not yet have its unification in the intellect of life. Humans are still missing, end quote. But challenging a simply anthropocentric reading of this account of humans coming into the world is a line that the angel Gabriel speaks as he introduces the second act and prepares us for Adam's arrival. The centuries have flown by, he says, like the winds of a squall between the dancing of the heavens e lento divenir della materia. It's only a few words in the ciclo, but Sturzo would return to this idea of the slow becoming of matter and more fully articulate humans' relationship to it a decade later. In the final chapter of his 1943 essay, The True Life, Sociology of the Supernatural. Everything becomes transformed, he writes, either in cycles or an unending series. Living things themselves, subject as they are to germination and corruption, in returning to earth or to the waters, give rise to innumerable germs of life as long as life is possible. Sturzo's theology here celebrates the recycling of organic matter from one living body to another. Human bodies, too, unify the scattered fragments of past vegetal and animal beings. But there's more. Sturzo goes on to cite the French philosopher Maurice Blondel and his theory of cosmic thought, according to which reality is the progressive realization of some original thought through subsequent stages of life. As Sturzo puts it, this thought, at every stage, postulates and at the same time conditions a higher development, so that the further stage on the one hand is a pacification, and on the other a stimulus to ascent, up to the flowering of thinking mind, that which attains consciousness of its being and of the reality of the thought that is to be found in the whole cosmos. In this culmination, all created beings share, each according to its own reality and capacity, not as individuals complete in themselves and isolated or capable of being isolated, but as part of a whole. Conditions is the operative verb here, and Sturzo later emphasizes it, referring to, quote, lower creatures as a long preparation and a rich conditioning of existence for intellective creatures, end quote. Humans may be more advanced in the attainment of certain intellectual faculties, but the conclusion we should draw from this, Sturzo says, is not a sense of superiority or dominion over other life forms, but an awareness of our indebtedness to and dependency on the vegetal and animal lives that prepared the way and made our existence possible. It's a process that happens slowly, which is why we have the long expectant pauses leading up to Adam and Eve's appearance in the ciclo. And it means that we can't define the human apart from the material earth in which we're entangled. As he says, in this culmination, that is, in the human intellect of life, all created beings share, not as individuals complete and isolated or capable of being isolated. Sturzo goes on in The True Life to present a corollary of Blondel's cosmic thought. The same process of material becoming that resulted in intellective life here on Earth, he says, can happen in other worlds of the cosmos that revolve around other stars, moving towards intellective life other than humans. If this is the case, then while life on Earth may certainly come to an end, it would, quote, surely be a forcing of the scriptural text to extend the end of our world to all the millions and millions of worlds and to bind up their fate with that of the life of humans on Earth, end quote. With, as Sturzo calls it, a cosmos in perpetual dynamism, any, quote, end is only individual and partial. And just as by their deaths, living things return to the Earth and make fresh life possible, so would the end of Earth mean that its matter and energy were taken up elsewhere in the ongoing cycle of a cosmos that, quote, evolve in a temporal continuity that does not call for any term, end quote. There's no escape from material creation. Sturzo's reflections in The True Life on the becoming of matter at a cosmic scale are helpful in interpreting the final pages of the ciclo, which I'll turn to briefly now by way of conclusion. After the sun burns out over the Antichrist Jerusalem, earthquakes destroy the edifices of human pride, and fire consumes the earth, purifying those, quote, infected clods of soil, polluted waters, and air made unclean by human sin. Then a trumpet blows and human bodies are resurrected. It's a traditional Christian image that again seems to fall back on an idea of humans as immune from the cycles of nature or extractable from their environment. But the words that the angel Gabriel uses to invoke this resurrection undermine this conceit. Osso nei sepolcri giacenti, disseminati per la terra, nel fondo delle caverne nascoste, cadaveri umani divorati da belve, travolti nei gorghi delle acque, trasformati nel seno della terra, polvere e cenere disperse dal vento, invisibili atomi che un dì foste e nervi e muscoli, udite il suono dell'angelica tromba. Soggette, componetevi di nuovo in nervi e muscoli. Scuotesi la terra e germina non erbe o piante o fiori, ma a nuova vita pronti umani corpi. Although this passage ends with the human bodies apparently overcoming death, it's telling that the more vivid imagery is a naturalistic account of decay. Bones scattered in the dirt, corpses eaten by beasts and swept away by water, and then transformed underground. This movement towards decay seamlessly becomes movement towards new life, not unlike the earlier continuity between the fleeing sun of the apocalypse and the daily evening flight of the sun towards the next day's dawn. The last line cited here works against itself, because in specifying that the earth is germinating human bodies, not plants and flowers, it intimates to our mind's eye just the opposite. We briefly do glimpse plants and flowers growing again, sprouting out of those human remains in the ground. We were supposed to have just witnessed the end of the world, but it seems that maybe the same organic cycles of decay and rebirth continue, and humans are no less entangled in their material environment than they were before. Just a few lines after this tempering of Christianity's eschatological expectations, a chorus of voices chant a hymn with the repeated invocation, Libera nos Domine. This appeal to God as liberator orients the ciclo again on a political plane. As would be emphasized in later strands of Marxist Catholic theology, God the liberator is the politically militant God, who intervenes on behalf of the oppressed to correct the social injustices of this world. God has liberated the people in Sturzo's play from the Antichrist regime, and Sturzo had every hope that God, working perhaps through Christian democracy, would liberate Italy from fascist oppression too. By here reasserting the political commitment of his faith, Sturzo positions his conviction that the Church must actively participate in the socio-political affairs of every age as the inevitable outgrowth of his ecological vision of a humanity that is inextricably embedded in the material stuff of the earth. Thank you.
Thank you. This was illuminating and fantastic talk. It's like an eco, a materialist reading of Don Luigi Sturzo. I didn't know anything about it, and it's very convincing. I'm wondering how, since I don't know much about Sturzo, what was his relationship with the actual church? Because this is kind of a Franciscan position, no? That he has. And actually, some of the lines that I was reading is like turning upside down and evoking very strongly the Franciscan position, like the Pope, like the encyclical you referred to. So I was wondering what, and you mentioned also the biblical attitude towards the nature, you know, that was one of conquering. So this is seems to be against that, you know. And how was he? What was his relationship with the actual church at that time?
Yeah, no, it's a fantastic question, and one I thought about a little bit. Part of it was shaped by, he was certainly connected to the hierarchy of the church in the Vatican, especially in that early period when he was organizing the Partito Popolare. And then that moment of exile starting in 1924, for almost over two decades, challenged it because he was no longer then tied to a diocese in the same way. And so it's interesting to note that this play was published without the imprimatur that some of his other writings will carry, because again, he wasn't sort of positioned within, he had more freedom at that point. He was again, though, once he then returned to Italy in 1946, he lived in Rome, and was again sort of in the Vatican all the time, particularly in then sort of determining what the Vatican's relationship with the sort of second wave of the Christian Democratic Party would be with De Gasperi. And so when it came to political discourse, he was right there in the midst of it all. It's also interesting to note that, I forget when now, for how many years, but he's in the first of four phases toward canonization. He's a servo di Dio. So there is, at least at this point, a sort of general consensus on the powers that be of the church that he was an orthodox enough figure. I found interesting that his citing of Maurice Blondel, Blondel was not an ordained member of the clergy, but he was a close correspondent with Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, the Jesuit priest who was a paleontologist, who was a very controversial figure in his lifetime, and has since sort of been allowed a bit more by sort of the more sort of powers that be the church. So it's, if people spoke more about this writing in some other more unknown places where we sort of get glimpses of Sturzo's materialism, one wonders if that would sort of shift how the church today thinks about him.
Was there ever any attempt to produce the play, or?
It was never produced.
Right.
There was an attempt in Paris. He was working with a composer, whose name I forget now, who was going to be composing the music, and he got to the first act, and there were some financial disagreements, and it didn't come to anything. And then there was a brief revival, sort of an attempt to perform, I guess, the music that was composed in the 1980s, I want to say, after Sturzo's death. But it was never, as we know, sort of published completely.
Did anybody ever critically respond? I mean, whether it's from the fascist literati nobody ever critically responded?
Not that I know, besides that sort of that private letter from Benedetto Croce. So he clearly read it. So some people were reading it. But I did get the sense that it was sort of, you know, it wasn't especially, in part because of the genre, that, you know, there were a sort of handful of, you know, plays that were meant to be these sort of maybe vaguely naive educational plays, you know, that began when Sturzo was a priest in Sicily. There was a play about, you know, how should the Christian respond to the mafia? What should a Christian do if he gets asked to participate in a duel? And so I think probably people saw this and just kind of dismissed it.
Is this play available for, I mean, could you buy it? Back then, probably.
Back then, yeah, and it has recently. I was citing the original edition, but it has been just recently republished.
No, because I'm thinking there's a writer by the name of Pietro Di Donato, whose last final work was called The Gospels, and it would pair incredibly well with a reading of this, especially with the apocalypse. Both of them have apocalyptic endings. That I think, and I don't know, you know, Di Donato spent some time at the Vatican because he did some work with saints and published for the Vatican. So I wonder if he ever ran into Sturzo. It would be interesting.
Well, thanks. It's very helpful. I didn't know about him.